He is Robin Leach. He is Jada Markin. This is Car Keys.
And I will start this week's show by discussing electric cars, because there's no question, despite my sometimes objections to the functionality of electric cars, that they are the thing that's going to change our world within 10 years, if not sooner, from the standpoint of the majority of cars that either states individually or states severally and European countries are going to be insisting get on the roads to cut emissions, to cut global warming, if you will, in the form of, you know, exhaust pipe heat and the like. Except that until battery recharging capability becomes as fast as possible and faster than current rates, except maybe the superchargers, which apparently can recharge some batteries, probably the smaller capacity ones, to 80% of their functional usable mileage capability in less than 30 minutes. It's still hard for me to fathom that those people who remain long-range drivers, Jay says there aren't many around, but there are enough. There will be a reason to have either hybrid cars and or gasoline-powered vehicles for some time to come.
Quick question.
That is my opening statement.
Thank you. Quick question around that. Are electric vehicles being sold in India and China?
Yes.
Small ones?
They are.
I'm sure there are. China, but, for sure. India, I'm sure, yes, but in what numbers, I don't know. China is pretty big on electric cars.
All right. I'm just trying, the global
they really
capacity
need to
for
get
pollution.
Electric cars into these highly polluted countries and cities in those countries, and China certainly is one. India certainly should be another. I do not know the answer to it. Africa, I have no clue whether there's an organized auto industry of or sales situation or plan of any kind in any of the African countries. They may still be riding elephants, which might be smart, because I don't know whether they pollute or not.
I read different things about electric cars, and I actually talked to people about electric cars over the weekend. Yes, there is skepticism, and Robin seems to be backing back from that, and maybe you shouldn't.
Should
not. No matter how many electric cars we put on the roads, we will still, the vast majority of vehicles in the next 20, 30 years will still be internal combustion engine, ICE engines.
I'm not talking about car manufacturing, just because of functionality.
Functionality,
and manufacturing,
demand,
and
the logic of it all, economics. There will remain a need for a long time to be for gas or diesel-powered cars. Now, having said that, and we go back to cross-country driving versus city driving, urban driving, I do think, and I think we all agree on that, that if you're driving a 30, 45-minute commute, even each way, in one of the major cities around the country, which is what most people do. We happen to live in a nice little isolated,
remote
part of the world that's beautiful and all, but the real world lives around big cities, and a lot of people spend a lot of time in a car, but really spend a lot of time and don't drive all that many miles. And for that, I think electric cars are the way to the future, that and autonomous driving. And I know Robin will say all sorts of things about autonomous driving and that it's not realistic. The fact of the matter is, when you are in a car in traffic at 20, 25 miles an hour, which dozens of millions of people do every day, driver-assisted, semi-autonomous cars are, I think, the way to the future.
Practical.
They are practical.
Well, you'll also limit your concern. You're not going to be waking up and slamming on the, you know, pressing the accelerator. There are certain things that you can absolutely save on with that sort of thing.
So, and to that effect, there's big talks about Ford and VW's
tie-up
in both in both electric vehicles and autonomous driving. Yeah. And VW brings to the table their, what is it called, MLB, MBE, their
architecture
flexible architecture for
basically.
Electric vehicles. And Ford will be building and selling a projected 600,000 cars in the next 6 or 7 years.
And
in Europe.
Are these all electric?
And VW is going to be building them because that's the tie-up that's going on. Ford and VW.
Are these all electric or are they hybrid?
No, these are all electric vehicles, which VW just came out in Europe with the ID, i3,
right.
ID. And likewise, VW will be investing heavily into Ford's autonomous vehicle company called Argo. So it's a big bet on the future. I personally think that an alliance between Ford and VW can be extremely powerful on the world stage. I think we've seen that they struck an agreement recently on commercial vehicles, mostly for the European markets, and I think South American markets. I think they are two.
Basically, high populist, but
I think it's a good match.
But it's a great match.
And
they've done deals together in the past. The big bet is that VW is the biggest auto manufacturer in the world, and is really betting very heavily on the future of electric vehicles. And some analysts in the automotive world do have doubts and say that it's extremely risky, and maybe it is.
I'm sorry. I was just going to say, doesn't it? What I am happy about is that people are actually thinking on two tracks instead of one or the other. Go on.
Okay. Europe will definitely lead the way, in my opinion. I sort of agree. I think Jay agrees. In the electric, the transfer to electrically powered vehicles. First of all, the countries in Europe are more like states in size. And so you can drive all day long and never go 300 kilometers or 400 kilometers, which is the more like the limit of most of the battery packs today. The other thing that will work always for commuting type, which is going to require a lot of installation, will be the charging stations at the workplaces. And if a company has a big parking lot, and let's say 50% of those people are ending up in electric cars, they're not going to be able to just have a quadrant of 10 charging stations at one end of the parking lot for people to charge their cars. They're going to have a charging platform at each parking place. Right now, if you're a Tesla owner, you go down to Waterbury, you go off 84, whatever exit is, and there's a 8-point charging, supercharging station for Tesla vehicles. I have never seen more than one there in my recent stops in the morning.
And how long
time.
Does it take?
Well, presumably it's 30 minutes. For a guy, you sit for 30 minutes and have your coffee, you get a pretty good charge in your Tesla.
Yeah. 20 minutes, I think, is like, what is it?
For 80% charge on the supercharging stations for the Tesla batteries. And charging rates are improving, but I don't know how fast they're going to improve to the point where, if ever, that you can actually charge a reasonably sized battery pack quickly enough to equate to filling your gasoline-powered vehicle or diesel-powered vehicle with that kind of fuel, which is under 10 minutes for just about anything you're running, except maybe a 150-gallon giant tractor-trailer tank. But Europe is already. I think there's some Scandinavian countries that are really escalating the conversion to electric car sales in their company, in their countries.
Yeah,
by 2025.
Norway, ironically, a big exporter of
oil.
Of oil, yeah.
Yeah.
Sells more than 50% of new cars are electric.
That's why it's, in my view, important to look at both sides. All sides.
Sides.
Yeah.
We might transfer into retro vehicles. There's an story of, do I have it here? I don't have it here. One of my magazines has a all-electric Bronco. And Bronco is the topic of this next segment because I'm holding in front of me, thanks to you, Jill. the article titled $300,000 Nostalgia Trip, on which there is pictured a 1969 Bronco, which I owned one lovingly. And I also owned a 1973 follow-up, same size, same vehicle, also jointly for a while, which has had apparently enough things done to it so that if the converter can get $300,000 for it, that is apparently the asking price. Now, I was going to say before I saw this headline that I am aware that built Broncos or restored Broncos are going between in the $80,000 to $150,000 range. I hadn't gotten as high as $300,000, so I'm not sure what this is made of.
So but is this restored to its original?
No, it's restored. The body and that is restored. But as I look at this, the old news it says here, nearly everything fixed to the dash, down to the aluminum knobs is original. But made to appear, it's bespoke, which means current, but made to appear vintage. And then the electronics, you now have an electronic speedometer display and a touchscreen radio display, so you can get Apple CarPlay and that kind of thing.
So you're basically building it. You're building. Is it like a model kit then? You know, I don't mean literally, but you used to assemble airplanes and stuff.
You've been able to buy custom radio installations for just about every vehicle on the planet for decades. It's not so easy with the modern cars where you have these major displays and 12-inch. Dash blaze.
How does it handle? Can you still flip it on by hitting a curb like you did?
Presumably. You know, I don't know whether they've got better shocks or not, but it's the same wheelbase. It's the same width. They haven't changed the length. And the older vehicles, it's interesting watching the new Wranglers versus the old Wranglers go down the road, because you can see that the new Wranglers are, I don't know whether they're as much as a foot wider than the original old ones, the Jeep Willys Jeep. But the old ones are really narrow. And when he's got these guys with these 35-inch tires, very jacked-up suspensions on the old ones.
I got to tell you.
You think you could hit a rock and bounce and roll it over.
I saw a guy on the Mass Pike this weekend, and he was in a fairly new, you know, the latest model Jeep Wrangler. With no roof, no windows, no doors, and he was working very hard on his AC vent to try to blow AC on his face, but I don't think it was going to cut it. I don't know if he had any sunscreen on, but I'm not sure he was having any fun at all.
Well, I don't know either, because it was 90 degrees on the pike, and those kinds of roads outside of the ocean side, where it was as low as 75 degrees over the weekend, because I have proof of that. But Jay's right. It's interesting that you can buy the Wranglers today with all the crash testing data and all the side impact, strengths that are supposed to be built into the passenger cars, and you can drive a Jeep Wrangler with the doors taken off the sides and go sailing down the Mass Pike or wherever at 75 miles an hour. You better be damn sure you're belted in, and I'm sure you are belted in. As a matter of fact, I do know that. Well, I know on my Cherokee, for example, if my door is open and I put it in gear, the emergency brake goes on. I can't go anywhere. That does not happen to the Wrangler drivers, I'm sure, because they would have the doors on their vehicles. But it comes to wonder what would happen if somebody were to T-bone the side of the car of a Wrangler when the doors are off. The frame is very strong, no question about it. There are pillars that are there between the doors and the front and rear sets of doors. But whether or not it would actually save you if you were...
Was the guy going between two exits, or did you get the idea that he was on an extended journey?
He was on a road trip, on an extended journey.
Jesus.
No, there are a lot of Jeeps on the road, let me tell you. They are packed with kayaks and stuff on the top. They've got bikes hanging off the back, and they've got kids.
Well,
it's
summer.
It's summer. Well, that's right. But the Wrangler is interesting because it is back to... You really can take it back to its roots and take the doors off. You actually can fold the windshield down on the new ones. And they've got all sorts of variety.
I think it's too big. I mean, if you want that kind of
thing. It is big.
I'm waiting for
Suzuki
to bring back
the what was it called?
Samurai.
The Samurai. Yeah. Suzuki. The thing that just did
somersaults
for you.
You know, India.
It's back out.
It's out in some of the Asian markets. Yeah. I have got those size vehicles still flying the roads.
That's just...
And the question is how, what is the new Bronco going to look like? Have you seen an actual picture? I haven't. They've been keeping it pretty quiet. It's going to be big.
Big. It's going to be like a Ford Explorer.
Yeah, it's going to
Well, that's what I'm afraid of.
Yeah.
And I think it'll flop at a certain level if it is not like the The late 60s when it first came out.
I think if you're looking for something like that, then you'd go ahead and you...
This is why the Jeep is so successful, though. The Jeep is still... The DNA of the current Wrangler is really true to form of the old Wrangler. And they have not rounded it off. They've made it stronger. They made it safer. They've made it more comfortable. But the body is still basically... very similar to the old Jeep, Jeep era.
Now, this goes back a few decades.
And it's great looking.
Like four. But didn't they learn that when they started with the Cherokees originally, the Grand Cherokees? Wasn't there still some there was some interest, I recall, in the Wranglers. I don't know if they ever discontinued, but there was people still wanted the what became or what is the Wrangler. You might not have been born.
Well,
I know Robin.
I don't know how to comment on that, and I'm not going to at the moment. I just want to go back to these nostalgia trip article because now, besides the Bronco picture, which is on page one, there's some classic Chevrolet pickups, and there's a classic Toyota Land Cruiser, which is also another icon of yesteryear, and it's rugged looking. I think it may still be built more or less like it was the FJ Cruiser in some countries. But and then there's the Dodge Power Wagon, which was, you know, the Dodge builds a Power Wagon. You wouldn't even, I don't
what
even.
What the heck was that?
What the heck was that? Jay, it was before you probably.
I guess.
It's great looking. There's a picture of it here, but the new ones don't have anything near look at it. And as one of these little segments in the article says, these retrofitting companies, we build the icon Broncos and other icon vehicles like the designers would have wanted
you
to
really
build.
You really are going down memory
and
lane,
then,
aren't you?
Before the accountants ruin their design. Well, it's before the accountants ruin their design, and it's also before the MPG mileage regulations ruined their design.
If it's a bespoke car, I wonder if you have the same problem.
Same what?
Problem.
Of what?
Of mileage regulations.
Oh, here we go.
No, I'm not.
So the current administration is planning to roll back all the EPA
mandates by the Obama administration
that were put out during the Obama years.
They're not going to cancel them, however. They're just going to roll them back. And I actually, Jay and I have gotten into this a little bit on the show, earlier show, and we still might, in that I agree they should be rolled back if the pickup trucks were going to be included in that original situation, because I don't believe pickup trucks at the current the large size vehicles can ever get 45 miles per gallon in a useful way. And I'll say that carefully because Jay's trying to get ready to say something. And since the mileage of pickup trucks is not really out of the 20s in any form or function, except maybe if it's a diesel-produced or powered vehicle, that the new diesels are going to come on and allegedly get up to 35 miles per gallon at 50
How
to 70 miles an hour.
How much were they getting?
18, 16, 21. They drag down
numbers.
The mileage.
So let me ask you a philosophical thing. So if you drive a pickup truck, you should not have to...
Yeah.
Make any efforts.
Well,
to
not at the same level.
They
should segment the pickup truck market away from the passenger vehicle, let's say the traditional SUV situation.
Or what my curiosity, first of all, is were the pickups hived off from the regular mileage?
There wasn't much discussion about it when they were saying that the manufacturers had to have a fleet average of up to 45 miles per gallon by 2000.
I think it's very complicated, and I think
it is complicated.
It's very hard to find a
consensus.
A consensus. I mean, I was very anti-corporate. What is it? What did they call it?
Corporate average fuel
economy. Because if you were a niche sports car manufacturer, how could you possibly have an average?
Right.
That was, you know, within
reason. Well, you're talking about
reason.
Ferraris and those, the high-powered vehicles.
On the other hand, it's also, those are not mass-marketed vehicles or not to the same extent as even trucks or sedans or SUVs. So it matters a little less. So I don't know how you come up with the right number. But I do think that those tightening EPA rules have contributed to promoting
much improved fuel economy.
Yes.
And I will testify.
There's also a very simple way of doing it, is you tax the heck out of gas, and all of a sudden gas goes
skyrocketing
through the roofs.
They're loath to do.
And cars will get better mileage over time.
But there's no question they've improved. You've got a four-cylinder. I can't imagine a four-cylinder Silverado will get better gas mileage than a six-cylinder. But it has been proven that, as I've said in this show, that bigger engines sometimes get better mileage in the same vehicle that smaller engines are installed in those same vehicles, with the idea that the smaller the engine, you're going to get better mileage. But if you've got the same size vehicle with a smaller engine that can't move it as efficiently as a big engine, you're not going to achieve that. You and I, Jill, talked about Audi A4s versus Audi A8s when I got them for loaner cars and drove them between the dealership and my house when I was dropping a car off for service. And the V8 got just the same or better gas mileage between the two points than the A4 with the four-cylinder did. Now it's changed a little bit. But there's no telling what the reduction in the CAF economy standards by the current administration will do. I don't want them taken away totally. I just wanted them reduced because I thought they were a little bit too high for logical reasons more than anything else.
True.
And the hybrid vehicles solve that problem.
Right.
And electric vehicles, of course, solve that problem.
So usually we take the last few minutes of the show for safety tips. Do you have any?
I have safety tips. I
want
to mention also IMSA weekend at Lime Rock Park coming up. Big weekend for sports race car
besides Lime Rock
fans.
Too. Or besides Lime Rock as well, elsewhere?
No, here at Lime Rock. okay. IMSA is the leading sanctioning body for endurance racing in the U.S., and we will have some pretty good racing. There is a two-hour race on Saturday morning and a two-hour 45-minute race in the afternoon. Both are production car-based race cars. A lot of GT cars in the...
What bodies are included? Are we talking about Camaros and Corvettes?
Yep. In one of the classes, in the upper class, in the WeatherTech Challenge on Saturday afternoon, you will see Ford GTs, Chevy, Porsches. Trying to think of what I'm forgetting here, but manufacturer-based
larger-sized cars for what is a fairly narrow track.
Well,
and it's good.
Fast
it makes
cars.
For
they're,
the,
fast,
they're
cars.
Fast cars too, but they are.
And it's good racing.
It's the point of racing, isn't it? Fast
it
car
is the point
track.
Of racing.
Quick question: is it the 20th?
That is the. I believe this weekend is a. I don't know what the dates are, but it's Friday is qualifying and practice day.
Friday the 19th.
Friday the 19th. That would make Saturday the 20th. Yep, you're correct. And it's all condensed into one packed day of racing, as we know, because there is no racing on Sunday.
So the packed day is Saturday.
Saturday.
Okay,
yep.
So, but you have to qualify on Friday for the...
One of the series qualifies on Friday, so there's a lot of track activity on Friday as well. And
let's go to safety for a minute.
Safety is don't drive a race car unless
you know how. I think you've got most of that in about Lime Rock Inn. I've seen a lot of people with flat tires on the highways and byways, and you know most new cars do not come with spare tires anymore, or else they come with the so-called donuts.
I still don't understand.
You
okay.
still you and but
what don't you
since
understand?
You're traveling with
you don't have a spare tire.
Well, you can get them in options.
Have you seen the
cars.
Size of wheels these days?
Yeah, or, but okay. still, have
well,
you said like
you can't fit those? Spares.
You can't drive without a wheel.
You cannot fit those.
I know. I had a flat tire this week. Actually, I had three. I had one.
Yes, let's talk about that.
There was
good.
One in another car, and I have a slow leak in another tire now.
So there you have
so
it.
But
Jay picked up staples in his tires, though. This goes
on a local road.
Yeah.
On a local road.
I was the fourth guy to pull
Probably
into that shop.
Probably they fell out of the back of a pickup truck of a contractor, and they littered the road. But it was interesting to me that the staples were deep enough or long enough so they actually punctured into the air whatever it is, of the air part of the tire that has air in it, so it allowed the air to leak out. And I don't think of staples as being that steep.
So it's a $250 fix. Thank you very much. I need a new tire. which, you know, brings us to big tires and big rims.
Cost more.
They cost more. Safety tip, speaking of tires, check your tire pressures. I mean, on new cars, we have tire pressure warnings and even digital readouts for the pressures of each individual tire. But on older cars, you don't have that. And proper pressure, tire pressure, is
crucial to tire life.
And safety and handling of the car.
Oh, yeah, that. He is Robin Leach. He is Jada Markin. This is Car Keys.